Merton, which is just to the west of Swindon, where I was the last couple of videos. And there's more. I touched on Purton with Purton Aia, which is the Purton Island, which is Malford or Moulton Hill Country Park. But anyway, I'm on my way. There is an Anglo-Saxon charter of this place, though I'm not really exploring it. I have some toponyms worth talking about. But there's an Iron Age fort here. There's a Roman villa, which you can't see anything apparently, but I might go and take a look. We'll see how we get on with the walk. I'm here to get some exercise and to talk to you about the ancient landscape and how it affects us today. Well, not quite. We're going to talk about the English language and who it belongs to. Even Old English has an English character about it. It has an essence that isn't Swedish, French, German, any of the African languages. It just is what it is. And you can hear it in the most basic sentences. The vulgar bass tone of English comes through. Certainly when we use technical language, poetry, more refined language when we're showing off, does non-English words enter into the equation. Though Old Norse is a factor, even in our most simple language, the simplest of our languages. But when the BBC described on More or Less, which is a fact-checking programme on Radio 4, they said the sentence, "Give me the bag or die," is mostly Old Norse with a bit of Old English. Is that true? So I've written to the BBC, which is one of the most, I've never done anything like it before, but I just wanted to ask them to check their facts. So give is based on gæva.
Hello, chaps.
Give is Old English, gjeven. Me is me. The is tha, which is the feminine version of the. Bag is balg, though that might be Old Norse. But balg is in Old English. Or is author, and die is diegan. And they're obviously, they have the tone of English. There's no need to go outside to England to look for sources, the basic source of those words. You know, I was a bit sarcastic when I wrote to the BBC, but it poses the question, whose English,
whose language, hello.
So it poses the question, whose language is it anyway? And regardless of what the truth is in the deep past of English, English has spread wide around the world. It is owned by multiple peoples, and there may be nationalistic reasons why some of those. So you know, English is still the language of the legal language of India, but the bureaucratic language of India. But you know, at some point we can expect it to change. But it's still, Indians are proud of their ownership of the English language. So my wife, who was born Indian, she says thrice. I never say thrice. My grandmother did. I can hear the word thrice and know it's definitely English. I can understand it. I can even, if somebody says once, twice or thrice, I'd go thrice, and I'd be able to join in with the word thrice, but I wouldn't voluntarily use the word off my own back. There would be no preemptive strike of the word thrice in my use, because English, British English, has a load of archaisms, but it's different archaisms to the archaisms used by Indians. And the same goes for Australians, Americans, you know, Jamaicans. It is an international language. But that doesn't mean, even though I acknowledge wholeheartedly the diversity of ownership of the language, doesn't mean we can go around telling porkies about where it comes from, and that's here.